sometimes a word ain't enough. Yes, he gives beautiful ashes, but I need practical. Then you read a story. You read the story on Daniel and see that the angels were fighting on his behalf. And when he sent up his prayer, it was coming. So you keep on praying, because one day, suddenly, God will show up. But you didn't know that God was already sending it, but the enemy was opposing it. But God's angels is about that life. So they're going to come to your rescue and make sure you get your breakthrough.
Welcome to It's Not Just You, Girl, where we are real, uncut, raw, and yet holy about the things we face in life as women and how we can overcome them. I'm your host, Aya, and let's get into this, joyful people.
Hi, joyful people. You guys will probably hear my voice. It's a little muffled because I'm a little overwhelmed, but in a good way. Overwhelmed with emotions. I don't know where you guys are currently, spiritually, but if you have tapped in to the spirit and have started to pray a lot more, and I'm pretty sure you hear a lot of people saying this is harvest season, this is due season, this is suddenly season, miracle signs and wonders are our portion, this is also judgment season, this is vindication season, this is restoration, retribution, a lot of moving parts, a lot of things are happening, as well as we're probably going to get into this, we hear about wealth transfer, we hear about a lot of things, just a lot of indications that this season is encompassing a lot. And when I think about God and I think about seasons, I feel like God, you know, I know that God is a God of balance. You know, there's heaven, there's hell, there's light, there's dark, there's good, there's evil. There's all these different things that kind of balance it out. And I feel like that's the reason for this season. It's like those that choose God, those that walk in his presence, those that tap into his spirit and do the best that they can to live righteously, to adhere to his word, to obey his calling, to obey his decrees, and walk like Jesus, love like Jesus, walk in humility. They are getting ready to reap even in the midst of chaos, even in the midst of things. Like, we are really about to see the epitome of Jesus on the boat. When the disciples are like, you want us to die? What is going on? Can you do this? And like, Jesus woke up because he was sleeping in the middle of a storm that was scaring them, to tell you just how raging the storm and the waves were. And this man is sleeping and then wakes up and he's like, you people, y'all don't have any faith, like, peace be still, okay? Like, I am on the boat, y'all shouldn't be worried. But I think we are getting ready to see a lot of that. So I hope you guys just flow with me, because this is just me being me. This is me wanting the Holy Spirit. So even before I go any further, Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, I just ask that you allow me to decrease all the way and your spirit increase. You put me on this platform. You gave me this podcast. You gave me all these things to do, to glorify you, to edify you, to draw people closer to you. So Lord, I don't want any of me to be in it. I want all of you to be in it. So help me to say the right thing. Help me to say exactly what each person needs to hear going forward, and minister to the hearts, as well as say what's going on in this season. Father, you said, call unto me and I will answer you and show you great and mighty things that we don't know. Father, I'm calling on to you to show me great and mighty things that we don't know, or other people don't know, to confirm for those who have been speaking to you, and give messages to those that need the encouragement or the motivation to go forward, or whatever it is that they're needing, that you are giving to me to give to that person that will listen to it. Lord, let it come forth from your spirit, from the Holy Spirit within me, in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, so yeah, I'm feeling like we're getting ready to see a huge shift of those that have been in wilderness, those that have been stuck. I posted about Hebrews 11:1, where faith is the assurance of things hoped for, evidence of things unseen, which is a very, very eloquent and poetic way of saying faith is believing in something you can't see and having hope for it. Receive, it is already happening. It is already manifesting. You are basically praising God in advance. Receive, this thing is already here. You're already believing that it has happened. It's only a matter of time before you see it. And to be honest, that is what it is. When you pray to God, things happen in the spiritual realm before they get here to the physical realm where it happens with us. Things manifest on the spiritual side before they start to manifest on the physical side. So when you are rejoicing because of this prayer, when you are signing those receipts, those prayer receipts that you are sending up with thanksgiving and praise, you are calling God to move in ways that are out of this world. So I think, sorry guys, my daughter just walked in. But we are just getting ready to see a huge move and a huge shift. So those of you who are in the wilderness season, you are getting ready to break through. And I know we've been hearing a lot of breakthrough. We've been hearing a lot of suddenly. We've been hearing a lot of miracle signs and wonders. We've been hearing all of these things. And it comes from, you know, some comes from desperacy. Some come from these things not, you know, you being hopeful for a very long time. And I feel like because of that, a lot of people are getting weary. But you have to understand that delay is not denial. And sometimes when God delays you in a season, you should understand your reward is going to be greater. He didn't delay you for it not to pop up. But, you know, God is a God of Ephesians 3:20. He does exceedingly abundantly more than you can ask or think, ask or imagine, whatever version of that you read. And we don't always know what's going on. We don't always know moving parts. I don't know if I posted that video or I was just flowing by myself. But I was reasoning that, like, God has each one of our lives, and it's like a trillion piece puzzle. First of all, 100 piece puzzle will perplex me. And I'm going to tell y'all now, I'm going to be done. Okay? Done. But let alone a whole bunch of microscopic pieces to piece your life together. And God knows where every piece goes. He knows what time and what day this piece will fall into place. He knows what time and what day it will come together for you to start getting the pieces of the picture of your life to fall into place. And because he knows it so intricately, and for each of us, he knows all these trillions of pieces. We can't piece it together. We can't maneuver it. And God already knows how this thing will play in place. He knows what he needs you to learn before you get there. He knows how he needs you to mature and grow before you receive this piece. He knows all of these things. And for those of us who, by God's grace, I'm realizing that it is truly, truly a gift. I was very emotional it's truly a gift to sit in quiet time and really hear God download to you, not just about you, but also on behalf of people close to you. Sometimes he gives me messages for people close to me or people around me. I don't believe I'm a prophet, a prophetess or thing like that, whatever it is. But, you know, I sit in God's presence and I desire to know insight for some things just so I can understand. Even when dealing with people, sometimes I stay in prayer before I respond. And like the Holy Spirit will tell me, she not ready. He not ready. Don't say that right now. You know, and it saves a world of hurt, and it saves for that appointed time that God will set up for that person to be able to come back to you. He tells me when even I have problems and I should not tell my problems, and it's not a prideful thing. It's just God knows that you have gotten deeper with him, and this person is just touching the surface. So if you tell them this problem, one, it'll make them look at you with worldly eyes and give you worldly advice. And it's not going to allow them to come to you when they need to be able, for you to be able to help them the way that God wants you to be able to help them. Because sometimes you go through something in a season and you have to hold it and it just be you and God walking through that season. One, for him to show you that, like, when I say I got you, I got you. And when I say you're not alone, you are not alone. But also, had you invited all these people, it would have complexed you. It would have taken you off course. It would have made you do some things that are outside of my character and my word, because you had to feed off of my word. You had to look at these stories and insert yourself. You had to read Proverbs and gain wisdom to ensure. You had to read Psalms to console yourself, to be able to maneuver through this situation, unlike the way your flesh would automatically have you navigate this situation, which would have ended in a result that you didn't want. And let's be honest, wouldn't have given God glory, because you would have acted out of your emotions. You would have done things that were okay to other people, because they'll tell you, you know, like, well, you have a right to do this. You have a right to behave like this. But no, sometimes you have to humble yourself and like, yeah, I could, but God said he, vengeance is his, and he will repay. And he is the God of vindication and of justice. And you should just bless those that curse you. Because when I get through with them, so you have mercy on them for me and pray that they find me before I find them. Because when God is ready to humble you, he gonna humble you. You either gonna get knocked off your horse or donkey, whatever that was that Paul or Saul was on before he turned into Paul. Or he gonna swallow you up like he did the Israelites and Pharaoh. You choose. But something gonna happen and it's not gonna be pretty. But when you know that, you react differently. So God puts you in different situations for you to be able to maneuver and allow people to come to you when they need to. So you have to learn to remain silent. You have to learn to be quiet, because when God sets you up, he's setting you up for success. When he sets you back, sometimes it's a setback for a setup. We always talk about Joseph, but like that setback of him not only getting out of prison and being Pharaoh's right-hand man, then the Pharaoh's wife start pursuing him. Then he flees, like the Bible tells you, flee from temptation. He didn't say entertaining. He didn't say you're strong enough for it. He didn't say tell them be gone. He didn't tell them to give a seminar. He said flee. Flee don't require no words, but it requires quick moving feet. Okay? Get out.
And when he thought he was finally reaping the promise, he was finally getting ready to see his dreams, finally getting ready to see stuff, he gets thrown back in the dungeon for what he didn't do. And now he's not the high guard when he comes back. He don't have a high position. Even interprets dreams why he got set back. And was thinking, when this dude tells Pharaoh I interpreted his dreams, they gonna call me and I'm gonna be out here in about what? A week? A week goes by. A month goes by. 2 months go by. A year goes by. A year and a half goes by. 2 years later, somebody comes and says, get dressed. You're needed. Says, come. This guy told us that you have the ability to do this thing.
Mom, I go poop.
You go poop?
Poop again.
You poop again. Sorry, y'all. Sorry, you guys. We have been trying to get this girl to poop in the potty. She has been peeing in the potty on her own. She got that one down pat. It only took one day of letting her walk around naked. And she never had an accident. Went straight to the potty by herself. Just knew her body. She even woke up in the middle of the night a couple of times to go and release herself. So she just got that one. But poop, she just wouldn't do it. She wouldn't do it. It was like she didn't like it. She didn't like the way it feels. She didn't understand. And see this girl? Look at God. Look at God go come surprise me. Come on, big girl. Yes. Okay. Whew. Y'all. That was so surprising. But yes, like Joseph. You know, he answering these dreams. It go by 2 years. Then all of a sudden they come get him out of this dungeon. Set him up. Dress him up. Like they done shaved the man, washed the man, put royal robes on the man. Everything for him to come and give an interpretation of the dream. And even then, he wasn't so full of himself. He was still like, it is the God that I tap into that will help me interpret your dreams. I am not a dream interpreter, you know, and it was just amazing. And then he ends up being set up. And that's just the beginning of his dream coming to pass and full restoration, because then his brothers come, the famine comes, he sets everything up. They have him setting everything up in a high regard in the position that he dreamt about 17 or whatever years ago. His family comes back. He do a little trick and be like, you know what? Y'all stole from me. You got to keep the little brother and things like that. Almost want to kill his daddy because daddy was on a few legs. Okay. Can't get that man hypertension. He would have died. Okay. But that's another story. And does all of this only to be reconciled to his brothers and assure them that, like, look, I have no hate in my heart for you. And says the most amazing statement, what the enemy meant for evil, God used for my good. Look at that. And this is why we have to learn how to travail in the storm. Bear down in the storm, birth in the storm, trust the process in the storm. Don't lean on your own understanding. Have faith for the promise that God gave you. You don't know how it's going to be set up. Your human mind cannot process. It doesn't matter how smart you are not smarter than God. It doesn't matter what you know, especially because God knows not just about you, but how other people's lives fit into your life. So that person that's supposed to bless you, that you like, oh, it's this uncle. Oh, it's this auntie. Oh, it's this cousin. Oh, it's this man here. Or oh, it's this and that. And God can do a quick switcheroo. So what you thought was going to happen is not going to happen. And God does that sometimes. When you think you know what you know, you really find out you don't know what you know. Or when you think it's going to happen on this day, God might make you wait a couple more days, you know, because he wants a Lazarus situation. Like, nah, you already thinking this is what it is. And right now you can still kind of take the glory. I'm going to wait till it's dead and stinking for a couple more days. Like, it started to rot a little bit. You starting to lose. You done lost hope already and things like that. And then I'm going to pop up. You know, and that's the thing about the God of suddenly. We're always talking about suddenly, but yet we want to know insight of to how it's happened. God surprises people. If you know everything, how can you be surprised? You know, if somebody already ordered you an outfit and all these other things, set up the venue, you saw the receipts and all these things are in order. You know there's a surprise party waiting for you. It got to be, because it's your outfit. It's your size. It's your color. It's your dream dress. It's your dream location. It's a hotel that you enjoy. Like, you can't be surprised that way. God might give you nudges that it's happening, but he's not going to tell you what day, what time, and something about it is still going to shock you, because it's going to be something out of character or something that you know only God can do this. Only God can make it unfold like this. So I don't really know why I got on here to tell you the truth, but I felt led to do it, because we just have to learn how to trust God in the storm and embrace the pain. Me and my friend Essie have been talking about the whole book of Philippians and the whole book of James lately. And, like, the main theme is embrace the pain. Embrace the wilderness season. Use it to mold you. Use it to uplift you. Use it to humble you. Use it to make you more like Jesus. Use it to allow you to love and help people. I mean, there was one, I wish I could remember the scripture, but it was in Philippians. And he was talking about how when you are going through trials, you should encourage another. You should encourage another. When you're going through tough seasons, you should encourage another. Like, you know, most of the time it's like, I ain't got time to be talking to people right now. I ain't got time to be encouraging people right now. I ain't got time to doing this. But going back to the story of Joseph, Joseph could have been like, I ain't got time to be interpreting your dreams, because I'm trying to figure out if my dream is still going to come true, because I don't know why I am here and I did the right thing and I thought any day now, and now you telling me you got a dream. Like, and you know, and then see the interpretation of the dream. One of them was going to die and one of them was going to be released. So, you know, he'd be angry, like big mad, like, dude, why am I dreaming that you're going to get released? And then when it comes to fruition, he could have been like, excuse me, Lord. You gave me a dream how many years ago? Why am I back in a dungeon? And why you let me interpret this man's dream that he getting released? And he actually did get released. Mimi. Stop, babe.
Okay.
Thank you. But you know, It's crazy, but that's the thing. Like, you just gotta trust the process. God know how these pieces stick together. God knew exactly what he was doing. Why he set up a dream that can't nobody interpret, only for this man on that day. God put it on that man's memory. Who knows if God didn't embrace or didn't erase that man's memory for remembering Joseph for that time, until that appointed time that he has set it up, that maybe even the man has done such a good job that when he now said, oh, this guy interpreted my dream and mine and the other guy, and what he said was coming to pass actually came to pass. But he'd been doing such a good job that the Pharaoh was willing to hear him out. You get what I'm saying? Or he was desperate enough to hear from the cook about the guy he knows, and he happened to be in your dungeon. You get what I'm saying? Like, there is divine setup. When God is ready to open these doors, he opens these doors. But that's why you got to trust the process in the wilderness. Like I was saying, Mimi, God can't surprise you if you know what's happening. A suddenly can't happen if things look like they're falling into place. Like breakthrough can't happen without a wilderness season. There has to be darkness. There has to be a section where you don't know what's going or what's going to come forward. There has to be. And you have to trust him in that storm. You have to remind him of what he told. You got to remind him while you remind yourself. Bless you, baby. Lord, you told me. Lord, you gave me a promise. Lord, I trust you. Lord, I know your word does not return void. The promise that you gave me, your promises are yes and amen. The thing that you gave me, the plan that you have for me is to prosper me, not to harm me. So I know that I'm not going to stay here. There's a time there's a time to sow. There's a time to reap. There's all these other things. So I'm going to leave it as this is also sowing and reaping season, and I feel like things are happening quicker. There has been things that me and my sis have discussed. My sister friend. I got a lot of sister friends, which is awesome. But, you know, we have discussed, and literally a couple of hours later, if not a second later after we get off the phone, it's being confirmed. That's letting me know God is moving swiftly. God is moving quickly. So, in this time, what God has put on your heart, do it. If you don't know what he has put on your heart, spend time with him. Get to know him. Because I also feel like what he's about to do is going to be effortless. He just wants you to trust him. He just wants you to hold on to him. He just wants you to believe in him. He just wants you to rest in him and watch it all fall into place because you have prayed all the prayers that you need to pray. Right now, you are now praying prayers of thanksgiving to see if it's already happened. You have done everything that you needed to do. Even Apostle Paul says, when you have done all that you need to do, that you are called to do, stand. You stand firmly on the promise. You stand firmly on what God's doing. And you don't grumble and you don't complain. So I challenge you. She challenged me to read Philippians. She challenged me to read James 3. And I was like, I'm just going to read all of it. Because I remember James 1 got me through a very tough season. You know, because it's hard to consider it pure joy. And let me tell you, a lot of the things that you guys are confused about, you would get clarity if you would just read your word. And this is not me condemning you. This is me just explaining because you have a lot of people who do fear tactics. You have a lot of people that tell you things that are contradictory to the word. You have some people who speak like me and they don't always know the scriptures, but they are speaking the word. But then there are other people who are very, very eloquent and are speaking the world as if it's the word. And you don't know the difference because it sounds good. But it's not what God has called you to do and you don't know. You got to test the spirit by the spirit and you can only do that if you're filled with the spirit. You can only do that if you filled your spirit. You got to fill your spirit. You got to fill your spirit man with the word. When God tells you to put on the whole armor of God, you put on the helmet of salvation. The breastplate of righteousness. Your feet are to be guarded in peace. The belt of truth. And the sword of the world. Of the word. Of the Bible. The word. And your shield of faith. Look at that. The two main things you are fighting with. Or the three main things I should say are probably the most important. Is your helmet, because you got to guard your head. That one is guarded in salvation. Your shield, when them blows are coming, you count it back with faith. For it is written, for what my God said. Do like Jesus on the mount. When the devil was coming, he said, for it is written. You know the word, I know the word past you. You want to twist it up for me? That's not what he said. Because I have the word on my heart. And the sword, what you fight with is the spirit. You see what I'm saying? And those go hand in hand. You hold up your shield of faith and contradict that. I have faith because my word says, and that was a dagger. You just stabbed the heck out of that enemy. You just stabbed the heck out of the principality. You just sliced that stronghold in your life. You just karate chopped. Or what was that old school? Chop suey. Okay, you just chop suey. Y'all know I'm crazy, but for real. You just took that sword of the word and chop suey'd some generational battles. Your kids ain't gonna have to fight them. Because I'm saying that thing is roadkill. Deader than roadkill. It's overkill. Okay? You got to get to that point. So, trust the Lord. Trust the process. Keep being in awe of Him. Keep sitting in His presence. Keep looking at Him. And more than anything, y'all, I said this to a friend the other day because I don't think people realize sometimes you have to sacrifice in praise, sacrifice in thanksgiving. You'll see in Philippians 4, I think it's 6, where he says, don't be anxious for anything or don't fear for anything, but through prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, make your requests known, and the peace that surpasses all understanding will be upon you. I looked at it differently because I feel like people always say through prayer and supplication, make your requests known, but they forget the thanksgiving. But the thanksgiving is the important part. That's your warfare. That's what throws the enemy off course. My favorite song is Praise Him in Advance. Because some of the lyrics, he's like, I've had my share of ups and downs. Times when there were no one around. God came and spoke His word to me. Praise will confuse the enemy. So I started singing. I started dancing. I started clapping. People were laughing because they knew my problems and they knew my pain. But I knew that God will take them away. Those words are so powerful, especially when you're going through things. You've been applying everywhere and all you keep getting is unfortunately messages. You've been praying for God to fix your marriage or to put your family back together. And it's like all hell is breaking loose, or it seems like it keeps getting worse, or you've gotten to the point that y'all are just living roommates, or you guys are separated now, or divorce papers are on the table and so much is happening. At times like that, do you want to stand up and praise? Your child is wayward or left home at too young of an age, cooked on drugs. You got children that are still babies, but now they're having babies and you don't know what to do. You got toxic parents. Your friends don't really care about you. Or you wrapped up in sin, masturbation, fornication, adultery, whatever it is, whatever it is, pornography, whatever it is, social media, you doing something strange for some likes, but you still feeling empty on the end. See, we all have things. Workaholism. You throw yourself in work and you want to be glorified and people singing praises to you. So many things. But if you would, do the best that you can. And remember that when you are weak, you are made strong. And remember that the Lord said, if my people will humble themselves and pray, seek my face, and turn from their wicked ways, I will hear from heaven and I will heal their land. Then you get another scripture. So you've humbled yourself. You prayed to me. You said you don't want to do this anymore. You are asking me to come in. You have confessed to somebody close to you who truly loves and believes in you and understands, spirit-filled, understands the word. You've confessed those deepest, darkest secrets so God can truly heal you. Because it's one thing talking to him in the secret place, but it's another thing when you find somebody you can truly trust and you confess to that person. And then every time you get plagued to do that, or to think that you're a failure, or to reason that you're not good enough, or to say you're going to be broke for the rest of your life, or to say that you just can't stop doing this thing, or somebody sent you that text too long and you just don't know how to not, because you need somebody to love you on you, or your body is doing things that bodies do when it's not supposed to be doing it right now. Okay? So you're going through these motions and God says, don't be afraid. And don't be anxious, as well as don't sin, because I told you to turn from those wicked ways. Instead, come to me. Pray to me. Petition to me. Make those requests to me. Praise me. Then accept my peace. And you will be able to go forward. You won't know how, and you don't need to know how, but you know I will come through. And God's not a man that he should lie. And all his promises are yes and amen. If he put that in his word and you do it, it works. It works. Especially when you don't feel like it. We got to learn. Thanksgiving, praise, gratitude is powerful. Because it throws the enemy off course. Can you imagine? You do something you ain't got no business doing. You come out. You repent. You talk to God. And you start saying, Lord, I thank you for who you are. I thank you that you will deliver me from this thing that you know I don't want to do. I thank you that you have defeated the enemy and you will defeat him on my behalf. I thank you that he who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I thank you that if I stay in your presence, you will heal me 100%. I thank you that you are the God of restoration, that you are the God of grace. You are the God of peace. You are the God of mercy. Thank you that there is no guilt, shame, or condemnation through Christ Jesus. So if I call upon your name and I confess my sins to you and I confess myself to other people, Father, it's only a matter of time before I no longer do this thing again. Father, I thank you that you have healed me. I thank you that you have delivered me. See, let me tell you, that is your weapon. That is your weapon. You stand up and you fight. And you fight him in a way that doesn't seem well. Let me tell you, the things of the kingdom don't sound well. God, David defeated Goliath with a slingshot. That was supposed to thump that giant and make him even more angry to come pick up that little boy. But it took him out. Do y'all hear me? Israel been wandering for 40 years. Then they get to the promised land and God says, I'm going to need y'all to get some tambourines and some trumpets and march around this place a couple of times singing and singing praises. What? What? I'm facing opposition. You tell me this is the enemy and I'm going to have to fight to get into it. What do most people do? You put up your swords. You start ironing things. You get a fire going so you can sharpen that knife so you can dagger somebody. And he said, no, I'm going to need y'all to march and praise me. Then the walls came down. Especially because they kept going. And I think on the last day, they had to do it for 7 days. And on that seventh day, they had to march around it 7 times singing. I know some people were like, what the heck? This don't even make you telling me that that's how we're going to get in? Now, what if they open up and these people got guns and start shooting at us? What we going to do? Because this don't make no sense. Like, they don't want us to come in. But we supposed to go in, and this how we gonna do it? You sure? The things of the kingdom don't make sense, but they work, because the world knows what to do with flesh. The Lord knows what the world knows what to do when you start arguing. The world knows what to do when you act outside of yourself. The world knows what to do when you say you're a failure and you can't do this anymore. The world knows what to do when you become jealous of everybody who is doing good because you think your appointed time is not here. Instead of you to praise God for a friend, a seed that just happened to you. Her marriage is restored. My marriage is restored too. She just got that job. I just got a new job too. Oh my goodness. Her child came back. My child came back. Too. What? You praise God. Even if there's tears in your eyes and you don't really believe what you're saying, but you speak his word back to him. Ooh, y'all don't know. That's why you gotta embrace pain. That's why you gotta embrace the pain. You gotta say, God, how are you molding me? Because most of that is to get things out of you. You thinking other people are prideful and arrogant. They probably are, but you're prideful and arrogant too. That's why you don't ask for help when you need it. That's why you don't want to change things. That's why you don't want to give it up to God, because you think God ain't going to do it fast enough and you know better than him. But you would never say that because you know God knows better than you. But that's the way you act. Embrace it. What you supposed to learn? My marriage is not working. What's the Bible say about marriage? I can't find a job, or I'm not finding anything. What does the Bible say? What does Proverbs say about all these things? I feel like odds are against me. Don't nobody like me. I ain't got no friends. Things ain't working the way that they supposed to. What did David? How did David get through being oppressed and chased by Saul? And still deliver on God's promises. And still overtake those after him. And still be called a man after God's heart. What did these people in the Bible do? How am I supposed to behave? How am I supposed to react? What do these stories have in common with my situation? You even if you gotta Google it. What does the Bible say about rejection? What are biblical stories about somebody being rejected? Sometimes a word ain't enough. Yes, he gives beautiful ashes, but I need practical. Then you read a story. You read the story on Daniel and see that the angels were fighting on his behalf. And when he sent up his prayer, it was coming. So you keep on praying, because one day, suddenly, God will show up. But you didn't know that God was already sending it, but the enemy was opposing it. But God's angels is about that life. So they're going to come to your rescue and make sure you get your breakthrough. Girl, ooh, ooh, ooh. Ooh, if I ain't preaching or teaching, I ain't no preacher now, but I've done encouraged myself. But seriously, tap in, y'all. Tap in and get those things. I hope this blessed somebody. I know I've been all over the place, but I hope it did bless somebody and it was exactly what somebody needed. So stay wonderful, stay positive, stay beautiful, stay blessed, and remember, you are loved. Bye.